Chapter 31, The Photograph. The next day was most peculiar, as Mrs. Partridge would say. Phoebe arrived at school with another message, which she had found on her porch that morning. We never know the worth of water until the well is dry. It's a clue, Phoebe said. Maybe my mother is hidden in a well. I walked straight into Ben when I went to my locker. That grapefruit aroma was in the air. You've got something on your face, he said. With soft, warm fingers, he rubbed the side of my face. It's probably your breakfast. I don't know what came over me. I was going to kiss him. I leaned forward just as he turned around and slammed the door of his locker. My lips ended up pressed against the cold metal locker. You're weird, Sal, he said. Kissing was thumpingly complicated. Both people had to be in the same place at the same time. And both people had to remain still, so the kiss ended up in the right place. But I was relieved that my lips ended up on the cold metal locker. I could not imagine what had come over me or what might have happened. If the kiss had landed on Ben's mouth, it was a shivery thing to consider. I made it through the rest of my classes without losing control of my lips. Mr. Berkeley sailed into class carrying our journals. I had forgotten all about them. He was leaping all over the place, exclaiming, "Dynamite! Unbelievable! Incredible!" He said he couldn't wait to share the journals with the class. Mary Lou Finney said, "Share with the class?" Mr. Berkeley said, "Not to worry. Everyone has something magnificent to say. I haven't read through every page yet, but I wanted to share some of these passages with you right away." People were screaming all over the room. I was trying to remember what I had written. Mary Lou leaned over to me and said, "Well, I'm not worried. I wrote a special note in the front of mine, distinctly asking him not to read it. Mine was private." Mr. Berkeley smiled at each nervous face. "You needn't worry," he said. "I'll change my name that you've used, and I'll fold this piece of yellow paper over the cover of whichever journal I'm reading, so that you won't know whose it is." Ben asked if he could go to the bathroom. Christy said she felt sick and begged to go see the nurse. Phoebe asked me to touch her forehead because she was pretty sure she had a fever. Usually, Mr. Brookway would let people go to the bathroom or to the nurse, but this time he said, "Let's not malinger." He picked up a journal, slipping the yellow paper over it before anyone had a chance to examine the cover for clues as to its author's identity. Everyone took a deep breath. You could see people poised nervously, waiting as tensely as if Mr. Brookway was going to announce someone's execution. Mr. Brookway read, "I think that Betty," he changed the name, you could tell, because there was no Betty in our school, "will go to hell because she always takes the Lord's name in vain. She says God every 5 seconds. Mary Lou Finney was turning purple. "Who wrote that?" she said. "Did you, Christy? I'll bet you did." Christy stared down at her desk. "I do not say God every 5 seconds. I do not. And I am not going to hell. Omnipotent, that's what I say now. I say omnipotent and Alpha and Omega." Mr. Berkeley was desperately trying to explain what he had enjoyed about the passage. He said that most of us are not aware that we might be using words such as God that offended other people. Mary Lou leaned over to me and said, "Is he serious? Does he actually really and truly believe that beef-brained Christy is troubled by my saying God, which I do not, by the way, say anymore anyway?" Christy wore a pious look, as if God himself had just come down from heaven to sit on her desk. Mr. Berkeley quickly selected another journal. He read, "Linda," there was no Linda in our class either, "is my best friend. I tell her just about everything, and she tells me everything. Even things I do not want to know, like what she ate for breakfast and what her father wears to bed and how much her new sweater costs. Sometimes things like that are just not interesting." Mr. Berkeley liked this passage because it showed that even though someone might be our best friend. He or she could still drive us crazy. Beth Ann turned all the way around in her seat and sent wicked eyebrow messages to Mary Lou. Mr. Berkeley flipped ahead in the same journal to another passage. He read, "I think Jeremiah is a pighead. His skin is always pink and his hair is always clean and shiny, but he is really a jerk." I thought Mary Lou Finney was going to fall out of her chair. Alex was bright, bright pink. He looked at Mary Lou as if he had recently plunged a red hot stake into his heart. Mary Lou said, No, I know. It isn't what you think. Mr. Berkeley liked this passage because it showed conflicting feelings about someone. "I'll say it does," Alex said. The bell rang. First, you could hear sighs of relief from the people whose journal had not been read. And then people started talking a mile a minute. "Hey, Mary Lou, look at Alice's pink skin. And hey, Mary Lou, what does Beth Ann's father wear to bed?" Beth Ann was standing 1 inch away from Mary Lou's face. "I do not talk on and on," Beth Ann said. "And that wasn't very nice of you to mention that. And I do not tell you everything. And the only reason I ever mentioned that my father wore to bed was because we were talking, if you will recall, about men's bathing suit being more comfortable than women's." On and on she went. Mary Lou was trying to get across the room to Alex, who was standing there as pink as can be. "Alex," she called. "Wait, I wrote that before. Wait." It was a jing bang of a mess. I was glad I had to get out of there. Phoebe and I were going to the police again. We got in to see Sergeant Bickle right away. Phoebe slapped the newest message about the water in the well onto his desk, dumped the hair which she had collected at Mrs. Cadaver's house on top of the message, and then placed her list of further items to investigate on top of that. Sergeant Bickle frowned. "I don't think you girls understand." Phoebe went into a rage. "You idiot," she said. She scooped up the message, the hair, and her list and stormed out of the office. Sergeant Bickle followed her while I waited, thinking he would bring Phoebe back and calm her down. I looked at the photographs on his desk, the one I had not been able to see the day before. In one was Sergeant Bickle and a friendly-looking woman, his wife, I suppose. The second picture was a shiny black car. The third picture was of Sergeant Bickle, the woman, and a young man, their son, I figured. I looked closer. I recognized the son. It was the lunatic.